This is a Gluggle Jug, and it's absolutely the best way to serve water to someone because of the funny noise that it makes. It's good, isn't it? I really wanted to know what was going on inside when it made that noise. It's obviously something to do with the fact that you've got some air trapped in there and how the water interacts with that, but I wanted to know the details. So I went online and I was surprised to find there's not really anything out there. There aren't any diagrams or animations. You can't even buy one of these things made of glass so you can see what's going on inside. So I decided to do some of my own investigation. My first thought was that it's related to the fact that you can smash the bottom of a glass bottle by striking the top. That subject was covered comprehensively in a Mark Rober video. I'll leave a link to it in the description. But the short explanation is that as the bottle moves downwards, the inertia of the water inside creates a cavitation bubble at the base. It's a near vacuum inside that bubble. So the water rushes back in at high speed, and as it strikes the glass bottom, it smashes. Ultimately, I think that line of reasoning is a bit of a distraction, but you know, I'd filmed it already. And it's cool, so it's in the video. Actually, the Gluggle Jug reminds me more of that thing that happens sometimes when you're drinking water from a glass and the conditions are right, so that when you tilt the glass away from your mouth, a jet of water sprays out and hits you in the face. Does that ever happen to you? I mean, it's happened to me maybe 3 times in my life ever, so it's very rare, but I do remember a sort of glug sound that goes with it, or a glooey sound, reminiscent of the sound you get from the Gluggle Jug. So maybe this jug is able to create that effect in a very reproducible way. Like maybe that's what's happening inside the tail every time it glugs. The drinking glass splashback effect seems to be easier to produce in a glass that has a wide top and a narrow bottom. Here, look, as the glass is tilted back, that large body of water is channeled into a smaller area. As the cross-sectional area of the flow of water goes down, the speed of flow must go up. And the only place it has to escape is that small area left open at the top. Again, the narrower the channel, the faster the flow. That's just from conservation of mass point of view. So you see a jet jumping out, and under the right circumstances, that can hit you in the face. It's somewhat related to the Worthington jet. That's the jet of water you see when you drop something into water. That topic was covered in a Smarter Every Day video. I'll leave a link in the description. But in short, the water rushes into the space cleared by the pebble, and all that momentum is directed upwards into a jet that touches your bum. This is all hand-waving speculation, of course. What I really wanted to do was see what was going on inside. I wanted to create a transparent version. My first thought was to cut the thing in half, like this, and then slap some Perspex on there so you can see what's happening. Annoyingly, all these things are manufactured in an asymmetrical way, which makes that cut very difficult. Actually, cutting ceramic is really difficult anyway. So instead, this 2D version is laser cut from acrylic. The drawing for the laser cutter was based on a tracing of a picture of the Gluggle Jug and an assumption about the thickness of the ceramic. I wanted to make sure I was getting the internal dimensions right, especially in this tail section, because goodness knows what's happening to the thickness of the ceramic in that region. And given how hard it is to cut one of these things in half, I just bought another one and smashed it with a hammer so that I could inspect the inside. So this was the drawing for the outer plates, and this was the drawing for the separator. You may notice a problem, and thankfully Lisa at Quirkshop, who did the laser cutting, pointed it out to me. There's nowhere for the water to get in. So here's the updated drawing, and here's the final product. Let's see what happens. Well, that's a lot simpler than any of my theories. It's basically just bubbles moving back and forth between the two chambers, Whenever you hear a gloit sound, it's a bubble moving back or forth. It's like the glug sound you get when you pour water from a bottle, but it's different in a really crucial way. Look, with the bottle, air periodically rushes into the cavity, and when it does, it sets up vibrations in the air, and we hear that as a sound. But compared to the Gluggle Jug, it's much quieter. And that's because the sound is coming from a closed cavity. It's somewhat insulated from our ears. The reason the Gluggle Jug glugs are so much louder when you bring it up to vertical compared to pouring water from a bottle is the fact that the bubbles, that is to say the Gluggle Jug glug bubbles, are escaping into an open cavity. The sound that is generated is able to escape through that open hole at the top, and therefore it's louder in our ears. That explains why the glugs are more muted when you're tipping the jug. It's because the bubbles are traveling the other way into the closed cavity of the tail. It's my hypothesis that the pitch of the glug is the resonating frequency of this pipe. And that's something we can test, because the wavelength of the sound produced by a pipe that is open at one end and closed at the other when it resonates is 4 times the height of the pipe. That's because there's a node here and an antinode here. So the full wave is like this. Well, the spectrometer here says that the frequency of the sound is 480 Hertz. We can get the wavelength by dividing the speed of sound by the frequency. I'm going to say that the speed of sound is 347 meters per second. That's because it's about 28 degrees centigrade in here. So 347 divided by 480 is 0.72 meters. Divide that by 4 gives us, well, 18 centimeters. And look, yeah. That's not bad. So there you go, the Gluggle Jug. This video is sponsored by Private Internet Access. That's the VPN provider that my tech-savvy friends keep recommending to me. So why would you choose Private Internet Access as your VPN provider? Actually, why would you use a VPN at all? A VPN encrypts all the traffic coming from your device so that it can't be tracked or blocked by your internet service provider or your network administrator or, you know, depending on where you live, your government. Like, the situation's not that bad here in the UK, but even here, there are certain torrent tracking sites that are blocked. A VPN also changes your IP address, and in doing so, changes where in the world you appear to be, which means you can access content that's blocked by geofencing. And importantly, Private Internet Access works with all major streaming services like Netflix, which can't be said for other VPN providers. They also provide 24/7 live chat support, but for me, the main reason to recommend Private Internet Access is their transparency. Their no-log policy has been proven multiple times in court, and their software is open source. That means anyone can check how their software works. A single subscription can be used on 10 devices simultaneously, which is more than most other providers. And if you go to my special URL, privateinternetaccess.com/Steve Mould, you can get a 3-year subscription with 2 months extra free for just $2.08 a month. That's equivalent to 83% off. It's risk-free with a 30-day money-back guarantee. The link is in the description, so check out Private Internet Access today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.